By the end of 1915, there was stalemate on the Western Front. Germany's mainly defensive posture had cost France alone over 1 million men killed, wounded, or missing. With the opposing trenches stretching from the Channel to the Alps, Erich von Falkenhayn, chief of the German General Staff, looked for an indirect way out of the deadlock in the west. He intended not a major breakthrough, but a battle of attrition in a place the French would never give up, a place into which she would pour all her men and resources. With the French army bled to death, he reasoned, France would no longer have the will to fight, and Britain, isolated, would withdraw. Falkenhayn found such a place in northeastern France. The siege that ensued lasted some 300 days, cost over 700,000 casualties, and by its end, it was difficult to determine an outright victor. For France, this battle has become synonymous with national pride, national fortitude, and the will of the entire nation. It was the place that France rediscovered its identity and where the seeds of a united Europe were first sown. Verdun, 1916. Along this road in 1916, which became known as the Voie Sacrée, the Sacred Way, 4/5 of the French army came to the defense of Verdun. A small provincial city on the River Meuse, about 260 kilometers east of Paris. Once the lines of trenches had settled into position in late 1914, and with its ring of 20 major and 40 minor forts ringing the town, Verdun stuck out into German-occupied territory like an elbow. Germany had stood on the defensive in 1915, except for local attacks in the two salients, Ypres and Verdun. The defenses at Ypres had been forced back closer to the town, but Verdun had held, despite bitter fighting at the base of its salient. Vauquois to the west and Les Epages to the southeast suffered devastating mine attacks in the fight for control of the vital heights. Although the attacks were ferocious, the French held their ground. Despite the devastation wrought on the flanks, Verdun itself had remained a comparatively quiet sector. Indeed, the French commander-in-chief, General Joseph Joffre, did not take seriously the threat of an assault on Verdun, and gradually took most of the men and large artillery pieces away from the ring of defensive forts to reinforce other areas.
In 1914, Joffre had actually ordered that Verdun be abandoned because tactically it made no sense to hold on to it. The local general, General Saraya, just disobeyed orders, refused to obey, and they hung on to it. So Verdun is now the tip of a salient sticking out into German-occupied territory. And Falkenhayn's thinking is, if we threaten Verdun, the French will pour in more and more troops to defend it, and we will kill them. It's as simple as that.
Joffre was very successful in 1914, but he took fright at what had happened to the forts in Belgium and on the edge of France, which had been so heavily beaten into the ground by the Germans that he feared for the forts which France had arranged around her borders over centuries in many ways. And he decided that he would take the men and the guns out of the forts and spread them around the field.
Underestimating the threat to Verdun, and the belief that the system of forts was unnecessary to an effective defense, was to prove a costly error in judgment, both militarily and personally, for the French commander-in-chief. What Falkenhayn envisioned was a win-win strategy, to be the victors whether they took the city or not. The prize would be the destruction of the French army.
Falkenhayns Strategie von Verdun muss vor dem Hintergrund der Erkenntnis gesehen werden, zu der man Ende 1915 auf deutscher Seite gelangt war, dass nämlich tiefere Einbrüche in die Tiefe des feindlichen Raums höchstwahrscheinlich auf absehbare Zeit nicht mehr möglich sein würden. Dementsprechend kam er zu der Schlussfolgerung, dass es sinnvoll sein konnte, auf einem Schlachtfeld seiner Wahl nur einen geringen Einbruch zu erzielen, der den Gegner dann wiederum dazu zwingen würde, seine Kräfte auf diesen Punkt zu konzentrieren und um auf diese Weise den gefürchteten deutschen Durchbruch abzublocken. In dieser Situation sollte die günstige Topographie des Geländes nördlich von Verdun zusammen mit der damals noch gegebenen deutschen artilleristischen Überlegenheit dazu beitragen, die französischen Gegenangriffe zu verbluten zu lassen.
Falkenhayn's instrument for the prosecution of his plan was the German 5th Army, which had been fighting around the salient from the beginning. The 5th Army commander was the Kaiser's 34-year-old son, Crown Prince Friedrich Wilhelm. A gift to cartoonists, he was known to the Allied soldier as the Clown Prince, or Little Willy.
The Crown Prince Wilhelm often gets a bad press. He looks like a fop, he looks a bit stupid in many ways. Being the son of the Emperor, of the Kaiser, you couldn't think he was really fully qualified, but he was a much better commander than people realized. He was shrewd, he was far-sighted, and he also was a man who knew when to stop. As the Verdun battle went on, there came a time when the German high command still wanted to press on and on, but he said, enough is enough. There was a certain basic humanity and common sense about him, and he was actually liked by his men.
The Crown Prince appreciated what Falkenhayn wanted was a limited offensive, not a breakthrough. The destruction of the French forces was to be brought about by bite-and-hold operations. Decimate the French as they defend their ground, and once it's in German hands, crush them when they attempt to retake it.
The Crown Prince would have liked sufficient troops to advance on both banks of the Meuse. Falkenhayn wouldn't give them the troops. He said he didn't have them. He said it was essential to keep back one-third of the available German divisions in case of an Allied counteroffensive, which actually probably wasn't going to happen where Falkenhayn said it might happen. Ultimately, of course, we have the Somme offensive. But at the time, Falkenhayn is saying, the Allies will attack up on the north, I must keep the troops back. That was actually nonsense. The real reason was probably that Falkenhayn was worried that the Crown Prince might actually succeed in capturing Verdun. He didn't want that.
There was, however, a note of discord in German planning.
Here we see the difference between the strategist in his office in Berlin and the man commanding the soldiers on the ground. What Falkenhayn actually says in his operation order is that the Fifth Army is to develop an offensive in the Meuse area towards Verdun.
Crown Prince Wilhelm knew you couldn't go and say to your soldiers, sorry chaps, we're just going to waste your way. It doesn't matter how many people you kill or how many people kill you, as long as the battle keeps going. He had to say to them, we are going to take Verdun. There will be a parade in Verdun in 2 or 3 weeks' time. He had to give them an objective to strive for. Otherwise, the soldiers would have just lost heart. So that was his shrewdness as against Falkenhayn's rather, what should we say, academic ideas, which didn't work in terms of the practical reality of soldiers fighting a battle.
Wilhelm reasoned that he could manage the offensive by making gains, but not actually capturing Verdun, thereby keeping both the strategists in Berlin and the soldier on the ground happy. Forced to concentrate his opening moves on the east or right bank defenses of Verdun alone, the Crown Prince made his preparations for Operation Gericht, or Judgment. The 12th of February was assigned as D-Day. Villages behind his lines were cleared to accommodate troops. Brought in by about 1,300 trains, 6 days' supply of artillery ammunition, amounting to 2.5 million shells, were stored in dumps. Underground barracks, large enough for hundreds of men, were built, several just a kilometre or so from the French front line. German gains in 1914 had given them control over the major railway centers and provided them with excellent lines of communication. In the new year of 1916, these lines were extended to the fringes of the salient, where a network of narrow gauge railways penetrated the forests, delivering supplies to the front lines. The Crown Prince assembled some 1,200 artillery pieces around Verdun, over half of heavy caliber, to support about 300,000 infantry. The awesome firepower that he would unleash at the beginning of the offensive was to eclipse anything the French then possessed. The German superiority was in the heavy artillery, including the 13 Krupp mortars of 420mm, known as Big Berthas.
La bataille de Verdun est avant tout un duel d'artillerie. Les Allemands ont employé une artillerie très puissante au début de la bataille de Verdun et avaient déployé près de 1200 canons pour écraser littéralement les lignes françaises.
Auf französischer Seite hatte man in den Jahren vor 1914 in einem erheblichen Maß auf das neue Feldgeschütz vom Kaliber 75mm gesetzt, welches 1897 die Einsatzreife erlangt hatte. In vieler Hinsicht ein revolutionäres Waffensystem, war es insofern gegenüber anderen Modellen im Nachteil als eine hohe Schussfolge durch das Manko einer rasanten Flugbahn aufgehoben wurde. Zur gleichen Zeit standen auf deutscher Seite eine deutlich höhere Anzahl an schweren Mörsern und schweren Haubitzen zur Verfügung, als die französische Armee hätte mobilisieren können. Erst in der zweiten Phase der Schlacht wurde auf französischer Seite dieses Manko graduell ausgeglichen.
Although both sides used tethered observation balloons to track the movements of the enemy and spot the fall of artillery shot, the Germans had a further advantage in that their activities were guarded by the first air force in history to establish air superiority. Not only was it used for photographic reconnaissance, but its fighting scouts prevented French aircraft seeing and reporting on German preparations. The first principles of air combat and the first aces were established over Verdun. Among the famous names to fly over Verdun were the French aces, Georges Guynemer and Jean Navarre, whose red color scheme was later copied by Baron Richthofen. For the Germans, there was Oswald Boelcke. Flying for France in the Volunteer American Squadron, later renamed the Escadrille Lafayette, were Victor Chapman and Raoul Lufbery. For the opening offensive, Germany had collected together the largest force of aircraft yet seen in the air war. They gathered in 168 machines, 14 observation balloons called Drachen, and 4 Zeppelin airships. The Germans had the world's first true single-seat fighter at Verdun. The Fokker E-1, Eindecker, had a high kill rate by virtue of its machine gun being linked to an interrupter gear, which fired through the wooden propeller without damaging the blades. After less than 2 weeks, though, the French, in the guise of the Group de Cigogne, the Stork Squadron, with their skill and elan, took control of the skies over the salient. 120 French aircraft had quickly been flown in. The initiative then passed back and forth between the two pioneering groups of aviators until mid-May, when the French built up their squadron strength to over 220 machines, including the new Newport 11, Bebe. The Germans were unable to match these numbers at Verdun. While Joffre was busy redeploying forces and planning the 1916 Allied offensive on the Somme, one man was mindful of the threat that German forces posed to the vulnerable salient. In the Bois des Corps, on the right bank, a French frontline soldier and parliamentary deputy, Colonel Émile Drian, had been worried by the lack of preparation for what he saw ahead. He wrote of his concerns, and his letter was passed to General Gallieni, the war minister.
Député engagé volontaire, le colonel Drian a fait un rapport à sa hiérarchie, mais également au Parlement, sur les faiblesses de la fortification de Verdun, alors que lui-même avait très bien senti qu'il s'agissait là d'un point majeur, stratégique important du front occidental. N'ayant pas été écouté par Joffre, qui lui avait toujours à l'esprit son offensive sur la Somme de juillet 1916.
Joffre, furious that one of his subordinates had gone behind his back and not through proper channels, refuted Riant's charges. However, he was soon forced by events to revise his opinion.
Joffre finally accepts that Verdun really is under threat, and on the 12th of February, he gives the garrison two more divisions. Now, he was very lucky, because the 12th of February was the day the attack was supposed to start. But because of terribly bad weather and snow, it's actually postponed until the 21st of February. So once he accepts that there's a problem, it takes him a long time, but once he does accept there's a problem, then he starts to move.
For 9 days, the Germans had waited in snow, frost, and fog. The morning of the 21st dawned bright and clear. At 7:15 a.m., a shell from a 38-centimeter naval gun exploded in the courtyard of the Bishop's Palace in Verdun. More shells followed, hitting the railway station and the town. The principal heavy artillery action, though, took place on the French first lines of defense, in the woods and hills facing the Germans. The West Bank also received its share of shelling, so that the French would not be sure where the assault when it came would take place. Between 7:15 a.m. and 4 p.m. lay nearly 9 hours of the most severe and sustained bombardment yet seen in warfare. 850 guns were dedicated to wiping out the French positions on the right bank sector of only 12 kilometers. That morning, Colonel Drian gave his wedding ring to his batman for safekeeping and made his way to his bunker, R2, in the Bois de Corps. As he was giving his orders, the world erupted around him, and from his bunker, he saw the defenses which were so important to the security of his wood obliterated. In the first hour of the bombardment, 80,000 shells fell on the Bois de Corps alone. Drian's devastated vista was repeated across the whole 12 kilometers of defenses on the right bank.
People used to describe the artillery bombardments of the Verdun as though they were sort of great hands striking down at the soldiers. It was a terrible presence. Artillery became feared and hated at Verdun. In fact, soldiers on both sides, the infantry, had more sympathy for each other than they had for their own gunners. The French and the German infantry were, as it were, in the same boat, being pounded into the ground by this terrible weight of artillery.
By 8 o'clock, those French gunners who had escaped the German artillery and intense gas barrage could do little to help their infantry by counter-battery work. The few French spotter planes to get through the German scouts reported that it was impossible to spot individual batteries, as there were so many. They said the woods hiding the German guns were enveloped in one continuous sheet of flame. In that first hour, most of the French field telephone lines were destroyed, making communications with other units and headquarters impossible. Runners, men on foot carrying urgent messages and reports, were sent out, most never to be seen again. The artillery bombardment switched to the French front lines, and it rolled to the second line, the third line, then back again, every 15 minutes until 12 o'clock. Suddenly, all shelling stopped. The French got out of their shelters because they assumed an infantry attack was coming in. But then the artillery started again and caught many French soldiers out in the open. The bombardment went on until about 4 p.m. Then the infantry did move in. Initially, small patrols, groups of 10 to 12 German soldiers, bypassing any strong points that they came upon. They were accompanied by pioneers, combat engineers, to assess the obstacles.
The main infantry attack is going to come in the following day. So it's just patrols, really, on this first day. One of the corps commanders actually decides that the boss's orders don't make any sense, and he decides he will send his infantry in, and he does. The result is that by the end of that day, although the resistance has been more severe than the Germans thought, And although the artillery bombardment hadn't been as successful as they'd hoped, nevertheless, they had made up quite a bit of ground. They were well poised to crack on the next day.
Losses had been severe. One end of Drian's R2 bunker had been hit. To his left, bunkers R4 and R5 were smashed by direct hits, killing the platoon in each one. The trench lines were a shambles. Of Drian's 1,300 men, half were killed or wounded. Despite the destruction up and down the line, despite the losses, and despite the horror of a new weapon, flamethrowers, the line had more or less held. Drian addressed his men. "We are here. This is our place. They shall not move us out of it." Day two of the German offensive at Verdun began at 7 a.m. with another huge and terrifying bombardment. When it lifted at noon, the German infantry attacked along the entire right bank front. In the Bois des Corps, the whole weight of the 18th Corps moved forward against the ragtag remnants of Drian's two battalions of chasseurs. Pushing through on both his flanks, they opened fire from his rear. Distress rockets were sent up imploring the French gunners to unleash a defensive barrage, but none came. Twice the Germans were repulsed, but dwindling numbers of chasseurs meant that the forward lines and R2 could no longer hold out. Dividing his men into three groups, Drian retreated. As they scrambled back, the fire of three German regiments converged on them, and many were gunned down. Leading the second group, Drian stopped to give first aid to a wounded chasseur in a shell hole. As he moved to continue the retreat, he was hit. Those in the shell hole tried to pull him to safety, but they saw he was dead, shot through the forehead. Because of Drian's stand in the Bois de Corps, the Crown Prince's objectives for the 22nd of February could no longer be attained, and German confidence was shaken. The Germans buried Drian near where he fell. After the war, he was reinterred under a memorial to him and his chasseur, a few meters from his bunker. Colonel Drian held the Bois de Corps. He holds it still. There were other losses too on that second tragic day. The village of Aumont, the Bois de Champneville, and the Bois de Brabant, all taken. On the 23rd, Herbois, Wavril, and Brabant village. Samognon was lost, retaken, and lost again. The French artillery firing on the village, thinking the Germans were still in possession, destroyed their own men with what is now ironically called friendly fire. These first days of fighting saw the destruction of 9 villages, which would never be reconstructed, and are known as villages détruits.
Insofern lässt sich der Erfolg des Angriffs nur auf erstens, dass das sehr kurze, aber heftige Artilleriebombardement und die Trägheit der französischen Führung, die sich mit der Verstärkung dieses Abschnitts ausgesprochen viel Zeit gelassen hatte, erklären. Die Fortschritte, die in den ersten beiden Tagen gemacht wurden, waren mit die spektakulärsten, die seit Einsetzen des Stellungskrieges auf deutscher Seite erzielt worden waren.
On the 25th of February, the mighty Fort de Douaumont fell into German hands almost by default. Originally conceived as the linchpin of Verdun's defences when construction began in 1885, it was taken by one sergeant and a small group of men. Finding themselves unopposed, they slipped in through an embrasure in the wall, and taking the four elderly gunners by surprise, they stopped the fire of the 150mm gun, the largest in the fort.
Fort Douaumont was the flagship fort of Verdun and was known as such to the French populace. What they hadn't, the High Command hadn't told the French, that Douaumont had been reduced in its garrison from five officers and 500 men in 1914 to one warrant officer and 50 territorial gunners in 1916. So when, on the fourth day of the battle, Douaumont was taken, the shock to the French was terrific.
Le fort de Douaumont était sans doute le fort le plus puissant d'Europe. Il était redouté à juste titre par l'état-major allemand. Sa prise était presque théâtrale, puisque le fort était très peu gardé par une cinquantaine de territoriaux mal armés, mal préparés à défendre un si vaste navire. Néanmoins, la prise du fort de Douaumont a été célébrée dans toute l'Allemagne comme l'annonce d'une victoire décisive prochaine. Il n'en fut pas le cas.
As a result of the French losses on the first four days, Joffre finally took decisive action and appointed the 58-year-old General Henri-Philippe Pétain to command at Verdun at midnight on the night of the 25th.
Le général Pétain, à l'inverse du général Joffre, est un homme méthodique, mais surtout très économe des hommes. C'est quelqu'un qui est partisan, quant à lui, de la défense active.
As a commander, he was cautious, painstaking. He believed in really thorough preparation. He understood the importance of artillery long before most of his contemporaries. He understood the common soldier. He understood logistics, which not all French generals did.
On his arrival at his headquarters at Sully, Pétain telephoned his generals commanding units in the right and left banks. "Now everything is going to be all right," one replied in relief. In the morning, Pétain awoke with double pneumonia. Despite this, he began to plan and issue directives from his sickbed. He planned lines of defensive resistance, using the neglected major and minor forts. Pétain also set about carefully coordinating the defensive artillery bombardments. On the last day of February, a conference was held between Falkenhayn and the Crown Prince. Wilhelm demanded three things: that the left bank of the Meuse must now be attacked because French artillery fire was disrupting his units on the right, that the High Command would give him enough material on a large scale to continue the offensive on both banks. Thirdly, he wanted all offensives by his army stopped should they find themselves losing men more heavily and becoming exhausted more rapidly than the French. On the 6th of March, the Germans attacked on the left bank of the Meuse. This was no surprise for Pétain. In fact, he had wondered why they had not done so before. He had packed the left bank defenses with artillery in anticipation. After a fierce opening barrage, the German infantry attacked. There was no probing as on the first day. The battle ebbed and flowed, the ground being taken and then retaken many times. German losses were so high that they could advance no further than their small early gains. The front stabilized from a line just north of Côte 304 and Le Mort-Homme, both of which saw furious fighting, to the Meuse. The weather now interfered with German plans, plans that depended on artillery. The thaw set in, making movement of heavy guns forward to new positions through the mud very difficult and time-consuming. The terrain was pitted with shell holes, the roads had been obliterated, and the destruction of the woods removed any cover. The German guns in the open were now vulnerable to the French artillery. Even when they managed to get the guns in position, their troubles were not over. Shells exploded in worn barrels, killing crews, or dropped short, killing their own infantry, and getting enough ammunition up to the guns proved impossible. Fighting continued on the right bank, and on the 2nd of April, the village of Vaux fell to the Germans. On the 9th of April, both banks were assaulted. Next day, General Pétain's famous message to his troops was dispatched: "Courage, on les aura. We will get them."
Lorsque le général Pétain a été nommé pour sauver Verdun de l'assaut allemand en février 1916, sa priorité première a été d'organiser la défense, notamment autour des forts qui avaient été désarmés par Joffre en 1915. Il fallait aussi acheminer les troupes vers cet immense charnier, cet immense volcan qui était Verdun. Et la seule route praticable était la voie sacrée, la Noria, c'est-à-dire les allées et venues des hommes et des troupes et des munitions et de l'artillerie se faisaient par la route reliant Verdun à Bar-le-Duc.
After Pétain established the Sacred Way and the Noria system, the Voie Sacrée continued to sustain the defenders. Pétain's turnstile was working flat out. 90,000 men and many thousands of kilograms of materiel and supplies were reaching the battered town of Verdun every week.
Unlike so many generals of the First World War, he cared about his men, and that's why he made sure that they weren't just put into Verdun to waste away. He made sure that units went in and units came out. The Germans tended to put them in and leave them there until they lost all their officers, lost half their men. Pétain realized that what you had to do was to make sure to keep up the morale of the men, to give them their best shot, to make them feel that they were being cared for. Take them in, but bring them out.
To maintain the vital lifeline from Bar-le-Duc through snow and ice, then the muddy thaw, Territorial Army road gangs shoveled huge amounts of stones and gravel under the wheels of the convoys of lorries. In the busiest periods, one lorry passed every 14 seconds or so. Though they had three squadrons of aircraft capable of bombing, the Germans failed to hamper or destroy this lifeline.
They could, if they had wanted to, with a couple of decent bombing raids, close the Voie Sacrée down. But the probability is that Falkenhayn wanted to keep the Voie Sacrée open. Otherwise, how would he keep on bleeding France white? The point was that France had to keep on sending up her troops and her guns and her supplies and so on. And therefore, more and more people were brought up into what the Crown Prince rather succinctly called the Mill on the Meuse.
After 7 weeks of confused fighting, with huge losses on both sides, first Cote 304, then Le Mort-Homme were taken by the Germans. However, this was as far as they reached on the left bank, and assaults switched back to the right. On the 1st of May, the impatient Joffre promoted Pétain to command Army Group Centre and gave the task of recovering lost ground to General Robert Nivelle.
Le général Nivelle était nommé à la suite du général Pétain pour reprendre l'offensive sur Verdun. Sa politique s'inscrivait dans la continuité de celle de Joffre, qui était l'offensive à outrance, là aussi, quel qu'en soit le coût humain.
Once the front at Verdun is stabilized, Joffre feels that Pétain is too defensively minded. He's now stabilized the front, but what Joffre needs is somebody who'll go on the offensive and regain the lost territories. And Nivelle then takes over from Pétain, and Nivelle, by skillful coordination of artillery and infantry, does recapture a lot of the lost territories.
With him, Nivelle had his favorite subordinate, General Mongin.
The butcher, the drinker of blood, the eater of men. Mongin came from Lorraine, most of which had been taken by the Germans in 1870. This may contribute to his hatred of Germans. Mongin just wanted to kill people. Germans, if possible, but if there weren't any Germans, anybody would do. He would frequently personally take a rifle, go into the front lines and have a pop himself. He was wounded three times. He was very much the soldier's general, but inevitably, because of his belief in constantly attacking, casualties in units under his command tended to be pretty high.
Nivelle, as impatient as Pétain had been careful, entrusted Mongin with the recapture of Fort de Douaumont, which the leadership now considered to be of great importance to the French nation. Nivelle's security was so lax, however, that the Germans soon learned every detail of his plans. On the 22nd of May, Mongin, watching from the top of Fort de Souvi, saw his attacking force taking huge casualties. One French battalion to the right of the fort was surrounded, and having taken 72% casualties and run out of ammunition, was forced to surrender. Although some French troops managed to reach the top of the fort, and a brave few inside, the attack was repulsed.
Les premières grandes offensives françaises à la nomination de Nivelle pour reprendre le fort de Douaumont ont été particulièrement sanglantes du côté français. Des régiments entiers sont montés et très peu sont redescendus. Et d'ailleurs, il était une chanson, c'est sur le plateau de Douaumont qu'on doit laisser sa peau, une chanson française fort connue à l'époque et dramatique. Les tentatives pour reprendre le fort de Douaumont sont avérées par des échecs quasi constants. Les hommes se battaient sur la superstructure, mais le fort, très bien armé et très bien défendu surtout, n'a pas cédé.
Within sight of Douaumont, the Germans next had their eyes on Fort Vaux, which remained in French hands at the end of May. The defense of this fort was entrusted to the thrice-wounded 49-year-old commandant Reynal, who volunteered to take command on the night of the 30th of May. The next night, following a massive bombardment, the exterior defenses of the fort were taken, and the Germans established themselves on the roof. For the next 7 days, fighting took place in the galleries and passageways of the fort, some of it hand-to-hand, all of it at close quarters. As if the onslaught wasn't enough for the defenders to contend with, supplies of drinking water were running dangerously low, and soon Reynal's dehydrated men were reduced to licking the condensation from the walls. Although efforts were made to relieve the fort, it was now virtually surrounded, and early on the morning of June the 7th, besieged, heavily shelled, attacked not only by flamethrowers and grenades, but gas as well, only thirst conquered Reynal and his gallant band. Amid scenes of old-world courtesy, the fort was surrendered. Taken before the Crown Prince, Reynal was congratulated on his defense and on the award of the Légion d'Honneur.
The Germans were so impressed by the defense of Fort Vaux, when its commander handed over his sword as a symbol of surrender, the Crown Prince gave him his sword back again. He was honored by the Germans for the tenacity of his resistance. It was one of the great heroic stories of Verdun 1916.
The siege of Verdun reached its crisis at the end of June and the beginning of July. The Germans now used a new, sophisticated poison gas, phosgene, hoping to panic the French front line, now only 4 kilometers from Verdun. On the 22nd of June, phosgene gas shells followed yet another huge bombardment, and at 7 a.m., stormtroops attacked in mass formations. The Turmel redoubt on Froid de Terre Hill eventually fell, but only after fierce fighting with the defenders outnumbered 10 to 1. The delay in capturing Turmel gave the French time to bring up a battalion of chasseurs who, using bayonet and grenade, cleared the Germans from their next objective, the Froid de Terre redoubt. In front of Souville, the French 407th Regiment slowed down the German attack with machine guns, then counterattacked, throwing everyone they could gather into this, including an improvised reserve of telephonists, orderlies, cooks, and stretcher bearers. The Germans were forced back. This makeshift force had halted the German advance, and they reached no further than this on the right bank. This second failure at Souville marked the effective end of the German offensive, if not the fighting. Mongin, using Pétain's creeping barrage, counterattacked, retaking Fort de Douaumont on the 24th of October.
The French mounted a strong and powerfully prepared attack on Fort Douaumont. They got some very large guns themselves, 400 centimeter guns, which were really big guns, and they brought those into action too. And they hammered Fort Douaumont into the ground, as it were. But the Germans had done the same as the French had done. They had evacuated their troops so that not too many Germans were killed, but the French were able to storm into Douaumont, seize it, claim it, and say to the world, we have reclaimed our fort. We have reclaimed Fort Douaumont. Even though the cost was colossal, the achievement was great also and was lauded around the world. It became the great French achievement of 1916.
To the French public, this was a great victory. Douaumont was a symbol. It was of no military significance whatsoever, but it was a symbol. It had to be recaptured. And it was seen in France as being a great victory. In Germany, it was seen as a terrible defeat. The reality is, it didn't matter tactically. It was all about perception.
The capture of Fort de Vaux followed on the 2nd of November, and the Germans were driven back 5 kilometers from Souville in December. On the 1st of July, the British and French had opened their offensive on the Somme, turning Joffre's Allied plans for 1916 into reality. The Battle of the Somme slogged on until the middle of November, inextricably linking it with Verdun. Verdun had now become a holding action for Joffre and Haig's Somme offensive. and the Somme became a relief action for the mill on the Meuse.
By July 1916, the Germans are losing almost as many men as the French. The Crown Prince doesn't really have any further faith in it. Once the Somme starts, he's told there are no more reserves, he's got to make do with what he's got, and quite a lot of his heavy artillery is removed and sent up to the Somme to face the British. When Falkenhayn is dismissed in August and replaced by Hindenburg and Ludendorff, they both say no more attacks at Verdun, close it down. It also, of course, means that the Somme, which is originally going to be an Anglo-French offensive, with the French providing most of the troops, because of Verdun, there are, of course, less and less French troops available, so it now becomes very much a British affair. And although this wasn't the original aim of the Somme offensive has to take place, and it has to keep going on to relieve the pressure on Verdun.
Whilst they had inflicted huge casualties on the French, when the Germans wound down their offensive at Verdun, their victory was incomplete. Despite their appalling casualties, the French claimed victory at the end of the year. Remarkably, considering the death and destruction that surrounded them, the beleaguered French forces stuck to their task, and morale was maintained.
Surprisingly, perhaps, French army morale wasn't too badly affected by Verdun. They seemed to become resigned to it. There was a stick-it-out-at-all-costs attitude. Resigned, glum, dour, but they went on doing it. They seemed to accept slaughter, death, destruction, all around them.
Que dire du moral de l'armée française durant cette terrible bataille qui a duré 11 mois? Comme le souligne très bien l'historien français Jean-Jacques Becker, c'est à Verdun que s'est exprimé le mieux le sentiment de défendre sa patrie. C'est là où le sentiment patriotique a atteint son paroxysme. Les Français, les soldats français, mais aussi l'arrière, avaient conscience de défendre là le sol de la nation.
Nivelle had famously ordered, "Ils ne passeront pas." They shall not pass. Nor did they. The wider effects of Verdun were the fall of Joffre, due in part to his neglect of Verdun's defences. His successor, Nivelle, buoyed up by his triumphs at Verdun in the last 3 months of the year, formulated a grand plan to sweep his way to victory in 1917. Nivelle's overconfidence and continuing lack of security was to prove costly, and he suffered a crushing defeat on the Chemin des Dames in April. Over the 10 long months of battle, 4/5 of the French army had served at Verdun, sustaining over 377,000 casualties. It cost the Germans over 337,000. In total, then, over 700,000 men were killed, wounded, or missing during the siege.
In a sense, Verdun was one of the great, terrible, appalling battles of the First World War, just as Stalingrad became one of the terrible great battles of the Second World War. In fact, the two have been compared as examples of terrible sacrificial battles which went on and on and on, which were a new hallmark in terms of the awfulness of war.
D'abord, Verdun, c'est la première grande bataille industrielle. C'est là où, pour la première fois dans l'humanité, l'homme met autant de moyens de destruction. C'est la première grande bataille où on utilise des armes de destruction massive, l'artillerie bien sûr, mais les gaz naturellement et aussi les lance-flammes. Verdun, c'est aussi la grande bataille de l'aviation. C'est ici, dans le ciel de Verdun, que c'est pour la première fois affirmé, que pour la première fois, on a démontré l'importance de l'aviation de chasse.
After the war, on Thiaumont Ridge, an ossuary was built to house the bones of approximately 130,000 unidentified French and German troops collected from the former battlefield. On the other side of the road, in the beautifully groomed cemetery, lie 15,000 graves.
La bataille de Verdun en 1916 a sacralisé la notion de mémoire en France. C'est vrai que c'est une bataille extrêmement coûteuse en vie. Plus de 300 000 morts, plus de 400 000 disparus du côté français et allemand. D'autres batailles, bien sûr, ont fait au moins aussi bien. La bataille de la Somme, la bataille de la Marne. Mais Verdun, pour la première fois de l'histoire de France, a sacralisé, a montré comment tout un peuple pouvait s'unir pour affronter une épreuve terrible.
At the ossuary in 1984, the French president and German chancellor, holding hands, came to pay their respects to the dead of both nations at Verdun and set the seal on European reconciliation.